सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यंकरवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। शान्तिः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुरेव परं ब्रह्मा तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। So I came back from the trip yesterday and I was sitting preparing. That's when I realized that it has been a long break. No, 2 months I think. So this is in the new year. So let's hope we continue with very small breaks. We have reached up until the fifth Anuvaka. We will chant the entire fifth Anuvaka and then get into each mantra portion. So, those of you who know how to chant it, you have some copies in the temple bookshelf or the folder shelf, you can get yours. And those who want to own it, they can print it off of the web. The entire Rudram is available. So the fifth Anuvaka.
नमो भवाय च रुद्राय च नमः शर्वाय च पशुपतये च नमो नीलग्रीवाय च सितिकण्ठाय च नमः कपर्दिने च व्युक्तकेशाय च नमः सहस्राक्षाय च शतधन्वने च नमो गिरिशाय च शिपिविष्टाय च नमो मीडुष्टमाय चेशुमते च नमो ह्रस्वाय च वामनाय च नमो बृहते च वर्षीयसे च नमो वृद्धाय च संवृद्ध्वने च नमो अग्र्याय च प्रथमाय च नमः आशवे चाजिराय च नमः शीघ्रियाय च शिभ्याय च नमः ऊर्म्याय चावस्वन्याय च नमः स्रोतस्याय च द्वीप्याय च।
दो वी हैड ऑलरेडी सीन द फिफ्थ अनुवाक फर्स्ट मंत्र. Since we are starting, so I thought we will include the first mantra again. every anuvaka has got dhyana shloka. This particular dhyana shloka continues to be for both fifth and the sixth anuvaka.
Gauri karambujanyastam swarna shaila sharasanam ikshuhastam nararudham naranaritanum smaret.
This is the dhyana shloka for this fifth and the next sixth anuvaka.
Naranari tanum smaret.
Naranari tanum. In one form, there is both the masculine aspect and the feminine aspect. The most balanced form. And this is called Ardhanarishvara. So the dhyana vastu or the dhyana aradhya deva is Ardhanarishvara.
So Gauri karambujanyastam swarna shaila sarasanam ikshuhastam nararudham.
So how is this naranari rupa?
Gauri karambujanyastam.
May we meditate on that Lord who is in the form of the lotus hands of Parvati ji, who has got Meru shining like the bow. The Meru is made of gold and it is naturally shining, and in his hands it is shining further.
Ikshuhastam nararudham.
Ikshuhastam, he has the sugar cane. And then nararudham, he is in the entire creation in the form of human beings. In their hearts, he is to reside in this form. Now it is said, those who chant this continuously for 11 days, it relieves the individual chanting and making this upasana, meaning with this dhyana shloka, the fifth and sixth anuvaka, if chanted, then it is said that if there is any litigations, court battles, they will be resolved. And it is also good for those people who are planning for progeny, children. And it is also invoked in gaining longevity and prosperity. This is the power of this mantra or these two anuvakas put together. Now getting into the mantra portion. In this first mantra we have already seen, but we will recover it. Repeat after me.
Ikshuhastam.
So the ikshuhastam, there is one hand is Meru as a bow and the ikshu is the arrow that he is holding on in one hand.
Ikshuhastam, in the hand there is the arrow which is the sugar cane.
So repeat after me.
Namo bhavaya cha rudraya cha.
Namaha, salutations. Salutations to bhavaya rudraya cha. Salutations to the one who is the remover of sorrow. And he is in the form of this entire universe, bhavaya cha. So far, if you have observed till the fourth anuvaka, we will find that ubhayopari namaskaraha. There are two namaskaras offered after every name of the Lord
or every form describing the Lord.
Namo avyadhini ibhyo vividhyanti bhyascha vo namo.
So ubhayopari, in the beginning and the end, namaha. From 5th through the 8th, we talk about that Lord with one namaskara, which is in the beginning.
In this section of 5th through 8th anuvaka, the effort of the rishi, mantra dashtaraha, is to explain the Lord as the efficient cause, nimitta karana. The very first four names given, namo bhavaya cha rudraya cha namo, sharvaya cha pashupataye cha, the five aspects of the nimitta karana are very beautifully covered. Creation, sustenance, destruction, binding and liberation. This is the spread of the nimitta karana. So these are called the pancha kriya. They are not called the pancha karma, but it is called the pancha kriya. Panchakarma, then it becomes Ayurvedic. Panchakarma becomes a treatment. The difference between karma and kriya, if you have been coming for a long time, it's a very simple fact. Wherever there is absence of doership, then it is called kriya. With the doership, then it is called karma, which explains the entire karma yoga in simple format. Kriya plus karta equals karma. And what is the conscious effort of every individual? The conscious effort is from the karma that we are performing to remove the karta, the doership. So what remains? The action devoid of doership, kriya always remains, the act still remains. But instead, in our utter frustration, what do? We remove the kriya itself. And that is not the solution. Wherever we are, whatever are our responsibilities, the kriya has to be performed. But the beauty of it is without the doership. So these are the kriya, because the Lord does not have, does not carry forward with any doership. Therefore, it is called pancha kriya. Creation, sustenance, destruction, binding and liberation. You will see all five aspects of it through these first four names explained. Bhavaya cha. Salutations to that bhava. Now what is bhava? Bhavanti praninaha asmat iti bhavaha. That because of whom creation happens is called bhava. It is from the root word bhu. Sanskrit, all words origin is from the root word. And when you find the root word and various upasarga and pratisarga added to it, when we identify them, beautifully the meaning emerges. And a trick to understand Sanskritam is to increase the vocabulary and memorize 2200 dhatus. That's it. If you can memorize 2200 dhatus and understand the various suffixes and prefixes, the usage of Sanskrit grammar, then you have already gained mastery over Sanskrit language. And most of us don't get scared when I say 2200 words.
If you are from the Indian origin of whatever native language that you speak, 80 to 90% of the dhatu words are already there. You have to consciously ascertain the meaning of it, that's all.
So the dhatu here is bhu dhatu. Bhu to be, bhava to become.
That because of whose presence the creation happens. In the Shaiva Sampradaya, in the Shaiva tradition, as in Advaita Vedanta, we call Parabrahma Paramatma. In Shaiva Siddhanta, they call that Paramatma as Sadashiva. Therefore, the shloka that we chant, Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam. So, Paramatma is often referred to in Shaiva Siddhanta as Sadashiva. As in the Vaishnava, they call Paramatma as Narayana or Sriman Narayana. Sadashiva. Now, as soon as that Sadashiva Murti or the Sadashiva form recognizes the first creative urge, the conscious aspect recognizing the creative urge becomes Kameshwara. And his Shakti, that which is being recognized, becomes Kameshwari. And they both coming together in one form in the Ardhanarishvara as it was meditated in the beginning. The creation starts to be expressing in the existential format. From that Kameshwari, Kameshwara form, the creation comes forth. That because of whom the creation happens. Creation devoid of, creation understood as separate from Paramatma is called Mithya, illusion. Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya Jivo Brahmaiva Na Aparaha. So we keep hearing in Vedantic platforms this particular statement. What is the depth of this statement? The depth of this particular statement is that Brahma Satyam, Brahman or that Paramatma here in the Sadashiva is the Satya. Satya Trikala Abadhita Vastu. That which is eternal, that which is not broken, that which cannot be shattered in past, present and future, that substantial reality is called Satya. Brahman or that Paramatma is the Satya Vastu, Brahma Satyam. Jagan Mithya. When they say Jagat Mithya, for any initial seeker into Vedantic study, it throws us off balance. And the harder we try, the harder we get confused. How can this world that I can touch, I can feel, I can taste, I can smell, I can see, how can this be an illusion? Okay, I can understand if it is an illusion, if I am alone perceiving it. On this lectern, okay, first, do you see me? Thank you. Do you see this lectern in front of me? On the lectern, do you see this book?
Yes.
If it is an illusion, how is it that each one of us having an illusion is perceiving the same illusion?
This whole logic, if we take this line of thinking, it is a catch 22. We will keep trying to catch our tail and we never end. What does Jagan Mithya mean?
That aspect of Jagat, as I perceive, as I feel, as I can taste it, touch it and perceive it, that aspect of Jagat is Mithya.
To better understand this statement,
what is not Mithya is to be understood. Because the realized ones also seem to be a part of this world, seem to be interacting with this world. Now, what is the difference between their perception and our perception? They see the Jagat as not something separate from, other than that Paramatma. The entire expression of this creation is understood as the expression of Paramatma himself. Whether it be in the form of a book, in the form of a lectern, or in the form of various chara achara, mobile and immobile. All of these are perceived as Paramatma alone. When not perceived as the expression of that Paramatma and seen as limitations, with the attitude of securing it, procuring it, enjoying and indulging in it, that aspect of this creation is called Mithya. Does it make sense? And who is the one who is perceiving it? That individual entity is not something other than Jivo Brahmaiva Na Aparaha. That Jivatva is nothing but that Paramatma alone, yet to realize its true potential. So, whenever it is said in the scriptures, in the Vedic literature, that this entire creation, so kamayata bahusyam praja yeyeti, you know, from that sadvastu, all this, you know, sprung forth from. It is not to be understood, it is not to be misunderstood as something other than Paramatma started expressing as creation, but it is the very expression, it is the very extension of that Paramatma alone in this form. Yes. Why was there a desire to create? There are two answers to it. Why was there an urge to create in the first place? This whole thing. So there are 2 to 3 answers. The first answer, when you find him, ask him. It is something like a child's mindset, that answer was. There is something goes wrong at home and you call the children, who did it? And you pick the naughtiest one, did you? I don't know, you ask the one who has created it. Why am I liable to be answering it? So when you find that Paramatma, nail him down with this question. First answer. The second answer is that the creation as perceived in our Vedanta Darshana is not cessation of creation and creation of creation, but it is in a loop of manifest and unmanifest. And the entire creation is considered as anadi. Anadi, it is beginningless, like Paramatmavat. Paramatma is also anadi, creation is also anadi. Between the manifest and unmanifest, vyakta and avyakta, as in the entire creation comes into the avyakta form, all the individual vasanas get into the collective sphere, Hiranyagarbha. That's what I said. Before creation, why was there a vasana? There is never the concept of no creation. Creation has been anadi. That's what is the meaning of the word anadi. Vasana is also cyclic. Therefore, the creation is also cyclic. No beginning, it didn't say no end. Antavattu esham, it has got an end when you realize. Until then, the collective collective vasanas, when they come to that state of fructification, Paramatma recognizes that moment, and that is called the moment of creative urge. When it is like the clouds gathering from the collection of various water sources. When does it rain? When the right environment sets in, that the collected water vapor becomes dense and that starts coming forth. That collection of everything into that clouds is Hiranyagarbha for that water to rain. Similarly, all these vasanas collect. And Gurudev used to give an example. He says, oh, Sankranti just passed. So, in the villages, during the Sankranti Pongal festivals, one of the things that is bulk produced during that harvest season is sugarcane. And the sugar cane is harvested and the fresh sugar is produced. And during Sankranti time, there is this, mela, fair in every village. And they have these sugar candies, not candy, but sugar, not sugar rocks or cubes. Shapes formed out of sugar syrup.
Like jelly. Like jelly.
Not jelly. Not jelly.
Structures.
The structures basically formed. So, and they are all strung together in one string. So, you can buy a dog, you can buy a rabbit, you can buy various forms and shapes. There are molds. So, they pour the sugar syrup in there and let it settle. And then take it out. So, after the fair is done, so the scene is now getting into, zooming into the dialogue between the father who is owning that shop, announcing it to the son that the fair is done. Or it was on the first day of the fair and he saw that there was a huge demand for one particular thing. There was something which was not selling. So, what does the father do? He tells the son, take out all these, the cat form of the sugar which has been molded. put all the cat, put all the Trishula, put all that, put all of them and let them be melted. For an onlooker, it sounds like, you know, you are melting cat. What are you actually melting? It's the sugar. To be remolded as something which is on demand. Right? Similarly, Paramatma, when he merges everything, all these samashti vasanas get together, and when it is the right time for it to rain, when it is the right time for it to express, he recognizes that collective Hiranyagarbha sthiti. And that is the basis for the creative urge to be in first place. Okay. This is the second answer. Third answer is, create what? This is Mandukya Karika answer. Gaudapada Acharya often uses this logic. Whenever there is a situation wherein he is asked to justify by the Purva Pakshi is the one who is debating with him about the creation. And the Purva Pakshi says, what about the creation and the Nimitta Upadana Karana of the creation? So he says, that Jiva who is recognizing this creation is non-existent. So, that which is being perceived by that Jiva as Jagat, Jiva itself is non-existent. That which is perceived by a non-existing entity, what are you asking me to prove as Jagat? First prove there is Jiva, then I will talk about proving Jagat. Meaning there is only consciousness. That is what he is trying to guide the individual seeker towards that direction. For beginning, initial seekers, what they see is what they believe. So, this is seen. So, the Rishi's aspect of reaching to such mind is that all that which you see is nothing but expression of that Paramatma. So, all that which you are interacting is an expression of that Paramatma. Therefore, lifting that mind from the individual perspective of, you know, procuring it, securing it, indulging and enjoying in it, it is uplifted to perceive it as Paramatma. Three logics given. So, bhavaya, that which expresses forth as this bhava. For him it is his own expression which is bhava. For us it is bhava dukkha karanam. Bhava, we become that many within each expression, within each birth, we become lot of components put together. I am a son, I am a father, I am a husband, I am a professional, I am with job, without job, I am somebody who is secured, insecured, various things that I become angry, I become jealous, I become various emotions that I become, and in all this becoming there is a constant restlessness. Therefore, he is called in the next word as Namo Rudrayacha. Rudrayacha, that Lord who is Rodana Hetu Bhutam. Rodana Hetu Bhutam. Dukkham Dravayati Iti Rudraha. So he is worshipped as Rudra. There are various interpretations of Rudra. Rodayati iti Rudra. So, if there is one of your child who is the naughty one who is a prankster, who constantly, you know, carries an innocent face but does all the mischief, makes everybody cry. So such one can be called as Rudra. Rodayati, the one who makes others cry. But here the interpretation taken is with little more depth. Rodana hetu bhutam dukkham dravayati. That which is the cause for all my misery, rodana hetu. Dravayati, the one who flushes it away. Such savior is called Rudra. Now this bhava, if not understood, what does it become? It becomes the cause for my sorrow. So he comes here and gives me moksha karaka, the one who can liberate me from this wrong conviction. Why am I suffering? Not because of the samsara, not because of the bhava. Not understanding it properly because of my own wrong conviction. That wrong conviction is called my personal avidya. How do you remove avidya? Only through vidya. How do you remove darkness? Darkness removing agency. You know, people have their vans, right? Wherein they advertise about their, you know, we do air conditioning, heating system and plumbing. We do lawn mowing. So I can also launch my own company. Darkness removing company. So first consultation is free. I'm just making it up on the fly. Okay. Consultation is free. Because first I have to come and see what kind of darkness you have. Now, how old is the darkness? What is the texture of that darkness? Is it thick or is it thin? Is it dense or is it not? Do we need all that calculation? To remove darkness, if there was somebody who had established a company to sell these different products to remove different kinds of darknesses, he is smart enough to make the rest of us bhaja govindam, govindam bhaja, mudhamate. He has made us mudhamati. Because nothing else works to remove darkness. Provide light and it removes darkness. The wrong conviction is because of avidya. And how is that avidya removed? Only through vidya. That vidya, that knowledge, which is Shruti Pramana. Shruti Pramana, which is already well laid out in the Vedic scriptures. Tasmat Shastram Pramanante Karya Karya Vyavasthitam. Whenever in doubt, what should be the Pramana? Most of us would like to say, my experience is my Pramana. But how valid is that experience? Because many times what we see may not be what is. What are you talking? We are not that dumb. Do we not very regularly use the statement that today the sun set, or the sun sets in the evening at 5:48 p.m. The sun rises at 6:10 a.m. The poor fellow is wondering, I neither rise nor set. But don't we use that? The sunrise and sunset. Oh, it is just usage, Swamiji. We know the sun is stationary, it is the earth which is revolving around, therefore we have day and night. The blueness of the sky. Is there any blueness to it? Because of the blueness of the sky, we perceive blueness of water. Whenever somebody has to draw a globe, you know, the earth is drawn in various contours and various sizes of, you know, shades of brown, green. When it comes to the ocean, blue. Is the water blue? No. The perceived blueness of the sky reflecting in the water reflects only as blue. But actually there is neither blue there nor here, but we perceive it. Akasha neela, neela, neelavatvadi. So, not always that we can bank on the experience as a logical proof. Therefore, in all such situations, take Shastra as Pramana. Tasmat Shastram Pramanante. Rodana Hetu Bhutam Dukkam Dravayati Iti Rudraha. How does he remove that Dukkha? The reason I am going through all this Vidya and Veda Pramana is just to impress and get across that he is not a magician who is going to come with a wand and then, you know, abracadabra and suddenly it is gone. Now we see a lot of these animated versions, whether it is cartoon or the human characters acting, that Bhagwan suddenly comes and then there is a light flowing through his hand and it envelops that devotee and suddenly he is. Don't expect shortcuts happen. That suddenly there will be such thing happening. No. What will he do? He will provide the environment for such sincere seeker, that opportunity to learn that scripture, learn that knowledge, with which the wrong convictions are removed, the right convictions are established, and thereby transcending both wrong and right to experience that divine. Moksha karakaha rudraha te namaha. So the first one is bhava. Not understanding the bhava, we fall into bhava sagara, bhava dukkha. And the only way to remove it is to understand him as that rudra. Namo bhavaya cha rudraya cha. Now the next mantra. So far we had already seen, it was just recapping what we had seen. Repeat after me. Sharvaya cha, Pashupataye cha. No, I should have started with Namaha. Namah Sharvaya cha, Pashupataye cha. Namah Sharvaya cha, Pashupataye cha. Sharvaya, the Lord who destroys everything. Pashupataye, the one who is the Lord of all creatures. So, Namaha, Namaha, salutations to the one who destroys everything and to the one who is the Lord of all these creatures. Now, what does Sharvaya mean? Shranati hinasti iti sharvaha. What is the dhatu here in sharva? is Shru Dhatu. Shru not in Shruti kind of Dhatu. Here Shru is Shranati Hinasti Iti Sharvaha. Shranati Hinasti. The one who destroys everything. Shranati Hinasti. Hinasti means to destroy. Shranati here means to destroy. Now this is the third Kriya. What was the first Kriya? Create. The second? To liberate. And the third one is? He destroys. The one who changes everything. See, that is the law of this entire universe, that everything is under constant change. And how does he change? The one who is responsible for this metamorphosis of matter and energy to change different formats. And he is the only one who can change matter to energy and energy to matter at will. We have mastered to change matter to energy, haven't we? We eat, and until it gets digested, we work. Energy produced. You need something, you burn it, it produces light and heat. Fuel, you burn it, you get energy. So matter to energy, we have mastered it. Energy to matter, he alone can. But in its comprehensive understanding, the one who is responsible for the metamorphosis of matter to energy and energy to matter at will. It is not a mistake. It is not suddenly there was a big bang and suddenly something happened, that all the energy exploded. It was done at will. The one who withdraws everything unto himself. Destruction does not mean annihilation here. Destruction here means from the vyakta, it is going back into avyakta. Can you all smile? Good. Can you all laugh? Just try. It was a sorry laughter. Now it was a better one. It was almost like, you know, what weird thing. Laugh and I had to laugh. When I mentioned that it was not that great laughter, then so when you laugh, your teeth were vyakta. And you stopped laughing. What happened to the teeth? Went back into avyakta. And this is not from the perception of the individual who is laughing. It is from the perception of the one who is observing the one who is laughing. The standpoint has to be understood. Otherwise the confusion is, what vyakta, avyakta? I have the teeth whether I am laughing or whether I am closing my mouth. It is there. Perspective is from the one who is observing it. Therefore, death is considered in Hinduism in a very different sanctity. It is not considered as an annihilation of the individual, but it is vyakta and avyakta. Vyakta is birth, avyakta is avyakta nidhananyeva tyaktaka paridevana. This is from
अव्यक्त निधनान्येव तत्र का परिदेवना परिवेदना भगवद्गीता सेकेंड चैप्टर। अव्यक्त इज कंसिडर्ड एज निधन एंड व्यक्त इज बर्थ। द वन हु कंट्रोल्स द व्यक्त एंड अव्यक्त मीनिंग द वन हु विथड्रॉज एवरीथिंग। So when he withdraws everything, that which is withdrawn, all the vasanas are withdrawn as is. You go to a trip. What is that? Disney World? Right? So that Disney World, so entire family goes. So you pack your luggage and everything. Usually you go for how many days? 4 days, 3 nights? A week. Then you come back weak. So tired. So week's worth clothes and all the things necessary, you pack. You use your clothes, and after the purpose is served, again you fold them back and put it inside. You come back with your luggage to Dallas, and when you open it, what condition will you find your clothes in? Whatever condition that they went into avyakta, when you take them out into vyakta, they'll come back in the same condition. Isn't it? And if that were not true, with so much of travel that I do, I don't need to bother about washing and maintaining clothes. All that I have to do is fold them and put it back and travel. By the time I get to the next place, they are all clean and neat and ironed. Whatever are the vasanas, whatever are the prints and creases and dirt that it carries, it goes in, and when you take out, it comes back with the same thing. Doesn't it? Except for your wallet. You go there with a filled wallet, you come back with unfulfilled heart. The wallet is, yeah. Well, you can always replace the bill with the receipt. The wallet will still be full. Not full with the bill, but with the receipt. So whatever format that it goes in, into the unmanifest, that pressure of that vasana will be the cause for its expression again. So the one who withdraws everything unto himself, he is called Sharvaya. And here the presiding deity of the presiding deity aspect of this Bhagavan Lord Shiva as Sharva is called Agni. Agni is the presiding deity, fire. So we have seen the creation, moksha liberation, and then destruction. What are the two left? Sustenance and binding. Pashupataye namaha. Pashupataye namaha. Now pati, that word has got multiple meanings. One meaning of pati is the miserable one of the spouses. Husband. Now, why do I call them miserable? Because the definition of husband is that way. Husband kaun?
जिसकी हंसी बंद हो गई हो। वन मीनिंग ऑफ पति इज हस्बैंड, एंड जस्ट बिकॉज वन मीनिंग ऑफ पति इज हस्बैंड, यू कैन नॉट अप्लाई दैट मीनिंग एवरी विच वेयर दैट यू वॉन्ट टू अप्लाई इट। आई वॉज रीडिंग अ बुक रिसेंटली इन द पास्ट, एंड दिस लेडी देयर इंटरप्रेट्स एंड गिव्स सच अमेजिंग लॉट ऑफ मिसकंसेप्शंस प्रोवाइडेड इन दैट बुक। I was shell shocked as to what is the, where is she coming from with all these meanings. Then I realized, now what she explains is Ganesha and Kartikeya, sons of Lord Shiva, are gay. That is the theme of the book. Yeah, I was also equally shocked like you, reading through it. It's a horrifying read for me. Then I realized her interpretation was Skanda or Kartikeya is called Senapati. And what was the interpretation? Husband of the entire army. Therefore, he was gay. Ganesha is Ganapati, he is the husband of all Ganas, therefore he is also gay. See, from this platform, I can take a logic. If it is not right, I can censure the logic. But from this platform, I should not be censuring the author. So after the session you come, I'll tell you who is the author. This is called the Vyasa Pita Maryada. So you observe, even in Adi Shankaracharya's Bhashya, whoever comes with whatever logic, Mandana Mishra comes with Karma Kanda. He never censures Mandana Mishra. There is no personal attack. There is only the logic that he is coming forth with is shredded into pieces because it is not well founded. So whoever is the author, and one amusing thought as a relief for me was, thank goodness she did not interpret or misinterpret their father. Because the father is known as Pashupati, husband of all the animals. That would have been a disaster. Okay. Censuring apart, what is the second meaning of Pati? Pati means lordship. Lordship of what? The lord of, in this case of Kartikeya, he is the lord of the entire army. He is called the Senapati. Even today we use it in our modern army system, but a general is called Senapati. The one who commands, the commander in chief is called Senapati. The lord of the entire armed forces. Ganapati, the lord of all the Ganas, the one who controls all the Ganas. Similarly, he is the one who controls all the creatures. Now here Pashu is a beautiful definition of it. Pashyati kevalam iti Pashu. The one who with the various sense organs of perception and action only perceives but does not process it with viveka. Such one is called Pashu. Therefore, it becomes a norm that when we want to censure somebody, we often give them a parallel of Pashu. Why are you behaving like an animal? So recently I got a court notice from the Union Federation of All Pashus stating that we feel belittled and insulted when the human beings censure each other as Pashu. Please stop that. We are way better than. There is a, in my native language, Telugu, there is, you know, sometimes there is a beautiful poetry. So, the way it goes is, there is a father scolding a son. You know, in various languages, gade, similarly. Gada in Telugu is gadida. So, the father was censuring the son saying gada. And right outside there was a actual gada, actual donkey outside. And the donkey started crying. So the poetry is, the poem is, Adina matanu tappina vanini gadidi kodaka ane tittaga vinna a gadida vidana kodakani edchen. So the translation is, for somebody who was not upright and in holding his word, when being censured as a progeny of a donkey, thus having heard the donkey started wailing and crying, that do not censure me by telling me that this fellow is my son. Very beautifully said there. Here Pashu does not mean just the animal. Anybody aviveki is called a Pashu. If there is only data being received, information being received, but there is no intelligent processing, viveka is not happening, such one is called Pashu. Pashyati kevalam iti Pashu. Whenever we commit a mistake, whenever we commit something wrong, usually 99.99%, why did we do what we did? Temporary moment of aviveka, right? We slip because of aviveka, lack of viveka. So at that moment, what did we become? Pashu. Pashyati kevalam iti Pashu. And he is called Pashupati. What does Pashupati mean? Pashu samana agnyaninaha purushan palayati iti Pashupati. Pashu samana aviveka agnyaninaha. Agnyaniha, those who do not use jnana. And not just that they make mistakes, they make the same mistakes again and again, quite glamorously. Pashu samana agnyaninaha purushan palayati, the one who takes care of even such. Such one is the Lord of all the creatures or the creation, therefore he is called Pashupati. tad rakshanam. What is he doing there? He is protecting and sustaining them there. Palayati. Therefore, he is the one who is sustenance aspect of the nimitta karana of the creation, Pashupati. He is also called the binding agency. What does he do? The one who binds us to the sequence of cause and effect. The one who binds us to the sequence of karma and karma phala. Meaning he is binding us to be responsible for our own actions. Therefore, he is called Pashupati. We can't suddenly say that, you know, having performed an action, when the result starts coming, I cannot suddenly, I don't need it. This is not my turf, this is not something that I wanted. You may not want it now, but that is exactly what you had asked for. There are two examples that are popping in my head. One at a personal level. The first time ever I went to a upscale restaurant. I was in maybe 8th or 9th grade. I had been planning to go there. This happened in Bangalore. I went to that upscale restaurant. And as soon as I went there, the waiter there gave me a menu card. The menu card looked like a Bhagavad Gita book, like it's a thick one, you keep rotating it. I didn't know what to order, what not to order, what does each thing mean there, what is the sequence of ordering, nothing. So, there is always a first time. When the Shastra Pramana doesn't work, what do I do? I don't know how to read it. Because each one had its own name and I was reading those names for the first time and it didn't make sense. So I started observing what was everybody else doing. I had to catch that particular family or that individual who was ordering something. So there was this family of 4 or 5 of them and they had a menu card and they called the waiter. They were already eating. They called the waiter and then they said, one malai kofta. So having heard it, I also went through the entire thing, went through the thing and said, malai kofta. Okay. I said, one malai kofta. So he took that down and he was still waiting. I said, is that all, sir? I said, yes. He again looked with distinct clarity in his face. Bechara pehle baar aaya hai. That this fellow must have been coming here for the first time. Doesn't know how to order. So he looked very keenly into my eyes. Are you really sure that you want to order only this? I said, yes. And now he went, brought that little dish. So he placed that little dish there and I looked at him. I said, is that all? And he was also quite humorous. He said, that's what exactly I asked you, sir. Is that all? Then I had to spill my beans out. I said, look, this is my first time. Tell me what else to order. He was my restaurant guru. Then he explained how to go through the menu card. So he said, these are appetizers. See, when you don't know, there is nothing like, you know, feeling ashamed of and, you know, feeling awkward. So he asked, confirmed, do you mind if I tell you what to? I said, I am more than willing, please.
शरणम प्रपद्ये. जैसे दीज आर दी एपिटाइजर्स, दीज आर दी मेन डिशेज आर दी आंट्रे, एंड देन दीज आर दी थिंग्स दैट दीज आंट्रेज गो विथ. सो देर इज चावल, देन देर इज रोटी, देन देर इज पराठा, देर इज नान, देर इज कुलचा, देर इज दिस दैट. यू कैन ऑर्डर एनी वन ऑफ दीज विच गोज विथ दिस दिस दिस. नॉट दैट पॉइंट, इंस्टेड ऑफ लर्निंग I react saying that, no, no, I don't want it. That which is delivered to you is in front of you because you ordered it. I mean, this logic doesn't work in US, okay? My first experience in a Chinese restaurant, I cannot forget that. Explained to that fellow very clearly that no meat, no chicken, no fish, no oyster, no any other sauce, fried rice. So he comes with a fried rice with a piece of meat on it. And I'm like, did I not order a vegetarian? This is about 12 years ago. So he says, don't, not a problem. He brought another plate, took the chunk out. And he said, eat. I mean, if I had the power, I could take the water immediately and say, bhasm ho ja. You get exactly what you have ordered. Because that is the karma that you have put, and the karma phala is what binds you. First thing is, own it up. Be responsible. The one who binds the pashu. How do you put this pashu on track? If you have seen the, what do you call, the bull or the horse, they are yoked. How do you yoke this pashu? Bind it with the karma and karma phala. Cause and effect. Rakshana, that is what protects the jiva from not going astray, not losing oneself. You want to unbind yourself, then he is the one who is Rudra, Mokshakaraka, tells us or shows us the path to go beyond the karma and karma phala, cause and effect. Otherwise, that is also catch 22. Vasana leads to karma, karma leads to vasana, vasana leads to karma, and you are sitting there. How long will this continue? And this is not like a 3-hour movie that it will soon end. There is no miraculous end here. I don't know how Shakespeare even made that statement. In every, what do you call his work? Every play of his, you know, the final scene. Thus they lived happily ever after. Never ever understood that statement. They both come together, abhi to story shuru hua. Now is when life starts, and that is when there will be lot of story that will happen. How do you get out of it? Is the Rudra Tattva. But until you get out, to be in that field and to be directed well, that binding agency is karma and karma phala. So he is the one who binds, he is the one who sustains, he is the one who creates. He is the one who destroys or withdraws everything unto himself, and he is the one who finally liberates us from this samsara.
Namo Rudraya, Namo Bhavaya cha Rudraya cha Namah Sarvaya cha Pashupataye cha.
All five aspects of the
nimitta karana, the efficient cause, to efficiently manage this entire creation is thus explained in these four words: Bhava, Rudra, Sharva and Pashupati. Pashupati has two meanings, one as the binding and the second one as the one who sustains. Pashu because it is bound, Pati because he is taking care of them. Pashupataye namaha. We will read the next mantra, see the meaning tomorrow. Repeat after me. Namo Nilagrivaay cha Shitikanthaay cha Namaha. Salutations unto that Shiva who is Nilagriva, right here in the front portion of his throat, you know, where you put your head up, there is a little what do you call that portion? Huh? Adam's apple. That is the portion which is called the Nilagriva. That portion became blue. I'm not understanding in the play or in the drama, we put the entire neck as blue. No, Griva. Only this portion became blue. So, the one who is endowed with a blue throat, Griva. Shitikantha. Shitikantha, the rest of the throat, rest of the neck is still matching with the entire body. And how is his body? What color is his? Gauranga Sundara. He is white. So he is a red head Caucasian with a blue throat, blue neck. So salutations to the Lord who has a blue neck or with a white throat. Sorry. It is the white throat, white neck with a blue throat, Griva. But there is much more to this, two aspects. What is that? We will see tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.